Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Please take your seats. The acting executive dean, Professor Claudio, Professor Brenda Leibowitz, and our respondent this evening, Ahmed Esau. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you once again for attending this evening's inaugural event. It's a very special occasion for the university, the inauguration of a professor into the Academy of Distinguished Professors at the University of Johannesburg. We take it very seriously, as you will note by the pomp and splendor, but our respondent this evening decided that he was not going to wear a gown, and he is in true traditions of the talk around decolonization, making sure that perhaps Brenda will also, in her address this evening, also talk about decolonization of traditions. Some of us would argue that traditions are very important and sacrosanct and need to be maintained. I do think that the inaugural event at a university is one of those traditions that should be maintained. Whether or not we wear gowns for the evening is something that can be debated. We could have another kind of more traditional attire that goes with the event. But I'm not going to keep this a very formal occasion. I just want to welcome a number of friends and familiar faces, and in particular, I want to welcome my old boss, Nasima Bacha. Really wonderful to have you here. Thank you. I also want to welcome Brenda's husband, Andre Kirk. Andre, great to see you again. And a number of friends and colleagues from all our institutions, system institutions, Fitz University, Pretoria. Brenda tells me that she's got colleagues from Stellenbosch University that are here tonight, and also from Rhodes University. You're all most welcome. I think that the topic that Brenda's going to talk about today, and has made it as her topic for the inaugural address this evening, is an absolutely important one, and an issue that universities across the country are grappling with, and it's a large measure as a result of the hashtag Fees in School protest. A number of academics, strangely enough, you think that academics would understand the concept of decolonization, but we do find that it's something that is still very misunderstood or not properly understood in academia. And questions are always being asked about what do we really mean by decolonization, and what is the university expecting of us when they talk about decolonization of the curriculum and knowledge. And I'm hoping that in Brenda's inaugural address, she's going to share some of her thoughts on the work around decolonization. I should also add, and I know that Prof. Kurt-Luke is going to introduce Brenda this evening, but perhaps also to say that the University of Johannesburg, a while back, a couple of years ago, took the decision to establish the first ever university chair in teaching and learning, the scholarship of teaching and learning. We often feel that the National Research Foundation creates a number of research chairs, but they ignore and overlook the most important focus of the university, and that is the scholarship of teaching and learning. And so the university set aside from its own money and created a chair on teaching and learning, and the position was advertised, and the successful incumbent to that position is Professor Brenda Leibowitz. She's done a marvelous job in the 2 years that she's been at the University of Johannesburg, and she's contributed to deepening the scholarship of teaching and learning at the university. And I'm happy that she's going to share with us some of her thoughts on that matter as well. So ladies and gentlemen, on that note, I'm going to call upon the Executive Dean to introduce Professor Leibowitz.
Thank you, Professor Parekh. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Brenda Leibowitz is Chair of Teaching and Learning in the Education Faculty at the University of Johannesburg. Her key role at the university is to support the scholarship of teaching and learning amongst academics. She has given many talks and run workshops at universities in South Africa, on the scholarship of teaching and learning and related topics. She serves on the decolonizing the curriculum task team and the Senate Teaching and Learning Committee. She was the director of the Center for Teaching and Learning at Stellenbosch University. And prior to this, she worked at the National Department of Education, leading the directorate, Race and Values in Education in the Academic Development Center. And that was situated at the University of the Western Cape. And she was a high school teacher for 11 years. So she knows education. Brenda is presently convener of the National Pilot Scheme, the Teaching Advancement at University Fellowships Program, with funding from the Department of Higher Education and Teacher and Training Teaching Development Grants. She has been the convener of the Southern African Universities Learning and Teaching SALT Forum from 2014. She's team leader for the national NRF-funded project called Interplay of Structure, Culture and Agency, a study on professional development in higher education. And she also runs an interdisciplinary research project at the University of Johannesburg named SOTLE at UJ towards a socially just pedagogy. She is a member of several other funded and non-funded research teams, including one entitled Postgraduate Study in Uncharted Territory. Her research interests include professional academic development, the scholarship of teaching and learning, language and academic literacy and social justice in higher education, and she is a C2 rated professor. Brenda was one of the founders of the Higher Education Learning and Teaching Association of Southern Africa, called HELTASA, and she served as a chairperson for the first 5 years. She helped set up the Council for Higher Education HELTASA National Teaching Excellence Awards and was convener of the committee for 6 years. She is presently the book reviews editor for the journal Critical Studies in Teaching and Learning, for short CRISTL, and was previously an editor for the International Journal for Academic Development. She has edited and co-edited several books on academic development, on social justice in education, and she has authored and co-authored 46 articles in accredited journals and book chapters. And you can find in the booklet the references to these. I thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Brenda Leibowitz.
Saying thank you. I first want to say thank you to the University of Johannesburg for the, what I call the prescience of establishing this position of the Chair of Teaching and Learning. It's the only one of its kind in the country. But I think it's really important because people in academic development and teaching and learning support occupy an interesting and strange place in the country. To many extent, they do enjoy power, but at the same time, they're also in a strange identity position, often in an academic administrative position, not enjoying the identity or feeling that they're an academic, one of the tribe. So for me, having been in that position for so long, to be able to apply to become a chair and a professor is really important. So I think there are a lot of people in academic development in the country who look up to this position and to me and say, thank you, we see you in this position as a role model. So I think UJ needs to take account of that they have begun this process of acknowledgement. I also want to say thank you to my friends, two of which flew up from Cape Town for this evening, and I'm really delighted, and one who stayed over for the evening. And then also want to thank Lucia Thiessen for giving me comment, she's in Cape Town. And then I do want to thank my husband, can you hear me? I want to thank Andre because You know, in literacy studies, people always talk about the importance of the family. And we normally talk about parents and occasionally about siblings. But we very rarely talk about partners and their role. And in my case, he was a role model in the beginning, then a bit of a bully and a friend while I was doing the PhD, and now just very supportive. So I'd like to acknowledge that. Okay, so to go on with the focus of the presentation, which is about the link essentially between cognitive justice and social justice, I'll go into that. Considerations of the teaching and learning angle. Now, a lot of people talk about decolonization of knowledge, and it's often at quite a high rhetorical level, and I don't think the educational angle is enough discussed. I will also talk about the concern and the challenges and the way forward. And what I'm going to be talking about is more an international approach. I'm not going to focus my talk squarely on South Africa because I think it's important to see the international dimension of this issue. The setting, I think everybody knows that we've been having for the past, since last year already, March last year, the first calls for the decolonization of knowledge were issued. And this has unleashed huge energy. At UJ, we've got the Decolonization of Knowledge Task Team, which has already had three panels, and it's got another few to go. Cheryl Hendricks is here tonight, is chair of that. So we've been discussing it a lot, sociology department and so on. And it's also said in some of the discussions that whites can't really lead the discussion. In the international literature on decolonization of knowledge, it's been said that settlers can't lead it, it's up to us. And I understand that and take that on, but in my position, it's my job as chair of teaching and learning to lead this discussion in terms of the educational issues. So I'm owning that. Okay, and the irony of this is that people have been talking decolonization for decades now. It's not something new. And so much so that Maldonado Torres, who was here recently to talk on that first panel, made the comment in an article that the decolonial term refers to a shift in knowledge production of similar nature and magnitude to the linguistic and pragmatic terms. In other words, this is a very important body and of knowledge and way of thinking about education. There's a picture of him, he was here, and I discussed this in the blog, the address of which is at the bottom. But I would like to just go biographical for a moment, again about irony. Oh, one quick irony. I'm not unaware of the gorgeous irony of standing here in all this pomp and circumstance at an inaugural, and I was chatting to this with the leader of Black Thought, who I don't think is here right now, and he said, you know, it's a milestone, you must own it. I'm totally owning this evening, but it doesn't mean that I don't think we can't look at the topic of the rituals and say, how can they be hybridized? But I'll come back to that. I don't want you to think I'm not unaware of that. So when I was doing English 1 at UCT in 1976, we were part of a little group who were rebelling against the curriculum and saying it wasn't sufficiently relevant. So this is 1976 to y'all going on about this in 2016. What's that, 40 years on? Nothing much changes. And then when I was doing my honors in comparative literature at WITS in 1979, I had discovered Fanon and M.S. Césaire and thought they were wonderful and gave a seminar on M.S. Césaire. And my Marxist and postmodern colleagues were horrified, and because this is now essentializing, right? But now, again, people like M.S. Césaire have been kind of rediscovered. There he is in all his ages. To the extent that people have said, no, they were just misunderstood. And according to Jantz, can I pronounce that, the imagination of a blackness to come, a creative force. So we're going back to things that we've been discussing before. It's interesting to think about the same and the ways that this has changed. So if I go on then and talk about an essential point I'm wanting to make this evening, and it's a point that has been made by Boaventura de Sousa Santos, who's a writer originally from Portugal, he lives in the United States, and he writes a lot on cognitive justice, and I've been very excited by his writing recently. And he makes the obvious point that, in my view, cognitive justice must be accompanied by social justice. So we don't talk about the one without talking about the other. Then I'm wanting to bring to this debate the work of Nancy Fraser, a feminist political scientist who speaks about social justice in relation to participatory parity. And she's defined three domains, and they're totally interrelated. The domains of recognition, redistribution, and voice representation and framing. Now, recognition is more of your identity position and the status of your grouping, whether it's in terms of your race or your gender or your age or your social class. Redistribution would be more Marxist material in relation to things like fees, access to fees, computers, and so on. And the third one, voice representation and framing, is much more about who counts as a citizen. So who counts as a citizen as a student at UJ? What voice do they have? And what rights do they have to express their needs? And her argument is that these three, while we may tease them apart, are totally interrelated. And then another point which Nancy Fraser makes and which Salim Badat makes is that we cannot just have an ameliorative approach to change. We also have to have a fundamental approach. So we don't need, as a teacher, to just change what we do in the lecture room at a small little level and tell the students, yes, I recognize you. We need to change the conditions such that participatory parity can occur. And I just want to, okay, I'll come back to that point next. So what is so interesting about the decolonization project of students is that, in my view, and having looked at a bit of the utterances, students aspire to see all three of these dimensions of social justice. So in relation to decolonizing the curriculum at UJ, for example, at a panel, the first panel of decolonizing knowledge, the student speaker said, please let us see ourselves within the degrees that are taught. Otherwise, UJ, how is it an African university? So that's more at the cultural level, at the level of recognition. Then with regard to distribution, in terms of cultural capital, as well as material resources, countless stories were told by students at the same panel and others about not having the material or cultural resources in order to be able to study successfully at university. So, fees must fall is interrelated with roads must fall. But students have been expressing the need for power and to have their voices heard. So all three of these dimensions are very much present. But I have to say, in my view, that with regard to the issue of identity and status, I'm not always aware that all the different identity positions have been given sufficient accord, for example, gender in some cases, and in many cases, students foreign to South Africa. That's something I've observed at this institution. Nevertheless, can't see what I've written here. Okay, so tonight, I'm using three terms fairly interchangeably. The one is the colonization of knowledge, the one is the hegemonization of knowledge, and the third one is cognitive injustice. And what I'm talking about is, especially with relation to the hegemonization of knowledge, is one knowledge system which becomes dominant and ignores the value of or suppresses others. So the hegemonization of knowledge serves the interests of the powerful, and I'll talk more about that. So how does hegemonization occur? These aren't in any great order, but these are some of the ones I've been thinking about. So the first one is winning over people who are charismatic, especially with regard to religion. I think it often appeals to people in terms of their needs, social needs, and so on. The second one, via institutions such as the church, the religious institution, the school. The third one of violence. Well, colonialization, imperialism would be a case of physical violence par excellence. But there are other examples of hegemonization of knowledge which have got nothing, I think, overtly to do with colonialism, such as the Spanish Inquisition, when people were burnt at the stake. That was about ensuring that certain knowledges were suppressed. Then I think very important for us is standard setting and benchmarking. We only have to think of the ranking system. We only have to think of the journal system, which says this is the standard and everything else is outside of that. And that creates a notion of the hegemonization, because you want to obey that. You want to get that rating, that ranking, that prestige. So do I. And then the one of repetition and daily usage, if we think of the work of Kevin Kumashiro, the writer in America on anti-oppressive education, the daily repetition of certain ways of talking and thinking create our subjectivities as they are. Then the embedded relations of power and control, there would refer to the work of Basil Bernstein and how that is embedded in discourse and the way we talk and the way we use language in education. And then finally, coercion, which we've mentioned before, but I want to mention that again with an example from the book The African Child by Cameron Lay, where in I think it was Cameroon actually, he and his friends, school kids, would have been beaten on the hand for speaking in French rather than the vernacular. So these are all ways in which knowledge was colonized and how successful it's been. It's not that it happened, but it's the depth and extent of it. So that's the next point, that hegemonized knowledge is deep-rooted, so much so that we often don't notice it. And the first example in the little booklet that you've given is from Kevin Kumashiro, who says how as a teacher, a lecturer of students who are going to go out and teach in Hawaii, he taught them, he gave them a song and tried to use the song to show them, to critique the way that the Hawaiian way of knowing was colonized. But in doing so, he taught them to breathe and to stand in a particular position so that they could sing the song and then critique it. Afterwards, one teacher came to him and said, you know what you just did? You actually used a Western colonializing way of teaching people to sing. And he had obviously no idea he'd done that. So the point is that this is all very unknown, we're not aware of it. The second point is a very deep and long one, but it's about the dominant way of thinking that we are part of in certainly Anglo ways of writing and thinking, the Cartesian way of thinking, which according to people like Basil Bernstein and others, come from Judeo-Christian legacies, which is one that sees, okay, let me just stand back a step and say, in the pre-humanist period, people in Christianity would have seen God at the top of the hierarchy, and then people, and then animals. So very much the notion of a hierarchy. And in the humanist period, humanists were saying, no, it's human beings that are top of the hierarchy, that see and observe and understand and control and manipulate. And that way of thinking is so entrenched that most of us are not even aware of it. It dominates our thinking about time, research, everything. And people like Achille Mbembe are part of the group that critique this. And obviously you have other knowledge systems which don't adopt this position. And this position has very much an all-seeing eye that observes what you see around you rather than being within the situation. And the interesting point that's made by Visnathan on cognitive justice is rather cheeky in my view, is that even the detective novel is an example of this, because you have the narrator or the detective who's the all-seeing eye and who neatly sums up the position at the end. So how are we going to see that we, in our view, we're so inside it, most of us. And then a final simple point is that the colonized might have become complicit in the structuring of their own oppression. But I think somewhere in this debate, we've got to talk about we've got to ask the question, is there one powerful knowledge? And people like the Komarovs have said that there are many knowledges. And even in the West, I think they use the word West, there are powerful and powerless knowledges. And that in the South, there are powerful and powerless knowledges. And that they make really interesting points. I recommend their book to you. One is that the canon has interesting similarities in other cultures. And in relation to what I was talking to you about, this Cartesian way of thinking and the fact that you have this notion of the individual as autonomous, they spent time in Botswana, and they traced Botswana ways of thinking, claiming that that idea of the autonomous self, the individual who has to make themselves and be performative, is not that different. So while we might think that other cultures are very different, sometimes there are astonishing similarities. The final point that I refer to here is that the West or the North can learn from Africa. They give examples of where Africa has actually done things which have not been done in the West or the North before. But they also say that we can learn from the mistakes of Africa. And they say that the North and the West is evolving in many respects to the South and to Africa. It's a very interesting analysis. I recommend you to read it. I don't have time to go into it in detail. So what are the consequences of the global hegemonization of knowledge? The first one is that, and I'm reading from De Souza Santos here, is that it involves the destruction of the social practices and the disqualification of the social agents that operate according to such knowledge. So people in schools, people at our universities, lecturers, people in society, might even be workers on the shop floor, feel disqualified that the knowledge doesn't count. And that is one issue. Then I want to go on to another one, which is about the destruction of the social practices. Now, if you bear with me for a moment, if you live safely and securely within a hegemonized approach to knowledge, you don't always question it. And one of the biggest sort of conceptual frameworks in Enlightenment ways of thinking is about hierarchy, but also about categorization. So we categorize people according to where they live. We categorize plants. Think of the wonderful work that Carl Linnaeus did and Darwin did. But that categorization is very often accompanied by the notion of a value hierarchy. It's not a far step to go from that value hierarchy to the notion of eugenics, that whites are superior to blacks, that Germans or Aryans are superior to Italians and Jews, and so on and so forth. And so if you haven't got a comparative prodding of, but hang on, have you really thought carefully about this, it can lead you to huge abuses and abhorrent ways of thinking. And wonderful work has been done on this year by, in my view, a book by Steve Robbins called Letters of Stone, where he talks about his grandparents who perished in Nazi Germany. And he's writing from Cape Town, working at Stellenbosch University, and he talks about the work done by Eugene Fischer. And this work traveled to Namibia, and from there it became the basis of that approach of way of thinking about the superiority of Aryans. So I'm saying we need to be constantly vigilant about our ways of thinking. We don't get caught up in these kind of abhorrences and epistemicide. So consequences to go on about alienation, and this is particularly case with students at universities, school kids, and I'm going to go straight to the work of the Chancellor of this university, and I wish he would enter more into dialogue with us. And you know, I think we really have to get him to talk about this, because he's just so wonderful on it, and he's written such a lot about this kind of alienation. And he talks about being a school, I'll put it up, but I'm not going to read it. He talks about being a school kid and saying that the knowledge forms that they got at school were imposed from the church and from the university. And it did not link up with the knowledge forms of the street and the community and the home. And this had negative effects both on the knowledge of the home, the local knowledge, and the knowledge of the school or the university. And I'll just say at the bottom, we lived in it without the concomitant learned habit of thinking it. Our affective imaginations progressively got anchored elsewhere. So if you want to know more about local, and he's not saying for 1 minute that we shouldn't learn about Shakespeare, don't get me wrong, but he's saying that local knowledges and these other formal school knowledges are not coming together. And that's very important, I'm arguing. So there are various responses to this notion of a hegemonized or a colonized knowledge. One which is very popular amongst people like De Souza Santos and Visnathan is that there's a plurality of knowledges out there, and that depending on what it is, what questions you want to answer, that would lead to the kinds of questions you would ask, and therefore the kind of knowledge you would draw. I'm calling that a comparativist approach. And I'm going to read you the first sentence of what he says, Visnathan. Each knowledge system, if it is to be democratic, must realize it is iatrogenic to some extent. Now, I had to look that up in the dictionary, so bear with me there. It's saying that in medical disciplines, if you prescribe a medicine or if you prescribe a way of investigating something, on the way you might do damage. Doesn't say the solution's not a good one, but you might do damage on the way. So he's saying that knowledge systems can be damaging as well. And you can read the other examples there or in the long text you've got in front of you. So that's one view, that they're different knowledges and they exist side by side. And by the way, the Komarovs say that they're varied knowledges and the Western is just one of them. That's just another. But an interesting and different take is that by Raewyn Connell from Australia, who says she critiques the comparativist view, which she calls a mosaic theory of multiple knowledges. She argues for the strengthening of knowledge-producing systems in the South, including South America and Australia, saying that only knowledge produced on a planetary scale is adequate to support the self-understanding of societies now being forcibly reshaped on a planetary scale. So in other words, no, it's not that we've got all these different knowledges there and they're all useful, but we have to strengthen the knowledge bases of the South so that they can contribute to a coherent knowledge position so that we can answer the questions that need to be answered. Other responses are about hybridization, and there you see a newspaper cutting of a Rhodes graduation ceremony where the student brought in Tulsa dance. I don't know, Chrissy, if you're familiar with the story. But it also says with rituals like today, how can we do them differently? How can we hybridize? It's one approach. Another one is creolization, where one form is changed and is adopted or owned by local people. And that's by, again, Jabulo Ndebele and Glissant from the South, not the South, Central American area, and Glissant, and this is popularized at a workshop we had here by Kiers van der Waal. And I just have to read you this quote because it was very important to me, and please note that it was written in 1986 by Njabulo Ndebele. And it's, for me, about taking things that might be dominant and making it our own. So we don't only take what's our own and let them feed into the dominant, but vice versa. So he said, English, and he said this to the English Academy, English will have to be taught in such a way that the learners are made to recognize themselves through the learning context employed, not second-class learners of a foreign culture, or as units of labor that have to be tuned to work better, but as self-respecting citizens of the world. The idea of teaching English through the exposure of second language learners to English culture should be abandoned. If English belongs to all, then it will naturally assume the cultural colour of its respective users. So all these painful people who phone into radio SAFM and say, I don't like the way you're pronouncing English, I don't like the way you're starting your conversations, how are you, you're taking up time, you should just know that there are other ways of using English in this country. Okay, other responses from Walter Mignolo from Argentina are about border thinking and epistemic disobedience. And then the work of Ngugi wa Thiong'o, again, Achille Mbembe saying that we don't just Africanize. Recentering mostly means developing a perspective which can allow us to see ourselves clearly, but always in relation to ourselves and to other selves in the universe, non-humans included. So in other words, it's not just about which knowledge, it's much more about how we approach knowledge. And this is a point made by D'Souza Santos. And he says, he talks about an epistemology of absences. So instead of being a confident, all-empowering educator who's got a notion that this is the knowledge, you need to always be aware there's an absence here. There are other ways of thinking. There are other ways of doing it. Could be worse, could be better. We need to be open to those. And then, of course, the idea of common sense, which again D'Souza Santos writes about. He says it can be conservative. But if it's thought about in relation to transformation and against capitalism and so on, it can ignite the imagination. And he talks about the work of John Dewey there, who writes a lot about common sense. More, Ndebele says it's not which knowledge, but how, that we are ethical and confident. Then Maldonado Torres speaks about the need to critique the hegemonized knowledge to understand how it came to be so hegemonic. And then I really like this quote about affirming knowledges. And he's referring to W.E.B. Du Bois, who's in the picture. The theoretical attitude requires detachment and wonder. The decolonial attitude, which Du Bois advances, demands responsibility and the willingness to take many perspectives and points of view of those whose very existence is questioned and must be questioned and produced as insignificant. And for me, this is very special, and I think this is part of the job of the educator, to induce wonder in students. Then I'm going to go on now and say, well, it's not just about decolonizing knowledge, it's about decolonizing the curriculum. So let's come now to the university. So one view might be that this is very good because it would facilitate more effective learning, students would have more, be able more to identify with the knowledge systems, it would be easier for them. Another view that the present curriculum is not transformed enough, and knowledge is central to that, but that's Johnson in the picture, if you haven't seen him in the flesh, he's so prolific in this country. It would facilitate a more comparativist approach where a student would be aware that there are different ways of seeing the world, but more important that they'd be able to move around between them. And that's something I want to come to. Now, if we're going to argue that we need a stronger knowledge base or a system that's powerful in the South, then we need a critical mass of students, of scholars, who can engage in that way. So that's the semi-penultimate bullet, and then the final one is the redistribution of powerful knowledge is inadequate as an approach. That, for those of you who are in the education faculties, would know as a more Binstonian approach, which says that a social justice project involves making knowledge more, giving more people access to that knowledge. Whereas someone like D'Souza Santos would say, it's not enough in a capitalist society. We also need to change the knowledges that students have access to. We'll come back to that briefly. Now I want to go on, and I want to say that this isn't an easy project. It's interesting, it's terribly exciting, and what I neglected to say when I started is that I think students have done a wonderful job in igniting this exciting conversation, and I'm very excited about it. But it's complex. And one of the complexities, if we say, people think, oh, it's easy because if you make local knowledge available, if students identify with the knowledge system, then it'll be easy. But I'm saying, no, it's more complex than that. So there are various axes of difference. One of them is the metropole versus the periphery. That's the language of postmodernism or whatever. I don't know. The second one is white versus black, very common in our country. Similarly, very popular recently is the notion of the settler versus the colonized. But then there's also the global north versus the global south. And I found two maps on Wikipedia, no less, which show you on the left-hand side the traditional notion of north and south, and on the right-hand side one which shows you per capita distribution. So the countries where you are under average of the per capita distribution are in orange. Note in this particular one, I don't know what year it is, South Africa's orange, which is quite of significance. But what I'm trying to do by bringing those two maps up is to say there are various axes of difference, but also within them we should be very careful of seeing very clear-cut binaries if it's just white and just black, just periphery and just metropole. So we should be careful of those essentializing and homogenizing categories. But equally, these categories intersect. There are other very important categories that we need to talk about. One of them is schooled versus local, and I put in the brackets of the heading just to make it clear that someone like Leibowitz was writing in the 1960s, and he was talking about local knowledge. He was talking about black educational vernacular amongst urban youth in the United States, and saying there's this tendency, and he was reacting to the work of Bernstein, and he was saying there's this tendency to see it as deficient because it won't get you through the hegemonic knowledges that you require to pass and go to university. And he was showing the immense richness of those local knowledges. Very interesting in that respect is the work of Shirley Bryce Heath, who in 1983 published Waves with Words, which also looked at the knowledge that was hegemonic in schools and amongst the working class, middle classes in the Piedmont Carolinas in the United States. But what is interesting is she did not counterpose that with one working class or local or oppressed knowledge. She spoke about the people from the white working class Christian community and the black working class community. So there's more than one local knowledge, and that's really important. But it's such an interesting and important book because it speaks about, it's not just about the way students learn language and learn to use language and work with texts. It's about the way they manage time and the way they manage space. So these are all contrasting with the way we do it at university or at school. And then, of course, you've got someone like Basil Bernstein, who focused very much on class differences. And I think his work is really important, because what he's saying is that class differences are manifest in the way that language is used in families and homes. And this is very much evident in schools. And this is a very important contribution that he's made. And I'm saying we have to take these issues, these debates into account when we talk about the value and the importance of indigenous knowledges, local knowledges, and decolonializing knowledge and cognitive justice. But I want to go on to a person who people probably have not heard of, and that is David Goff, who was for a while the linguistics head of department at University of the Western Cape. And what is really interesting about David's work is he was saying that in all societies, no matter how traditional, you have a divide between the expert and the non-expert. The differences in the way language is used, the way power is owned, and so on. And he gives fantastic examples in South Africa about, this has gone completely off the screen. I want to read it because it was very exciting for me at the time when he published a book with his article in it. He says, it's gone completely off the screen. But he talks about Xhosa practices such as the releasing of the widow and the celebration of the new homestead and so on. And he's trying to show that in that traditional society, there are separations between the expert and the non-expert. It's not only something that's about school and the university. So you cannot assume that if something is in rural Tasmania or rural America or South Africa, that it's automatically easily accessible to the student. It might still be the language or the discourse of the expert or the traditional poet and so on. So we've got a lot to think about accessibility and elite and non-elite. Then I'm going to go on to talk about another axis, which is that of age and experience versus the youth. Now, very strong in the current discourse is the notion that the age of the chancellors, the vice chancellors, the professors, they must have had their time. It's now the time of the youth. And I think that's very interesting, but I think it's also, in my view, a little bit problematic. But both sides are problematic. I think the notion of adult, aged, experienced people who treat young people as ignorant and having only to learn is problematic. But I think it's also problematic to view people with experience and age and expertise as not having something to offer. But maybe it's because of how that relationship occurs that it's these tensions are built in. But just to go on a little bit, I want to talk about the irony of another postmodern way of thinking, which is about a group that see childhood as something which has been colonized and which needs to be decolonized. And this is very strong in Italy in the Reggio Emilia school and in Scandinavia. And these are people who are trying to argue for a different way of responding to children. It's very fascinating. But the irony of it is I was at a workshop recently where this position by people like Dalberg and Moss articulated, and one woman in the room said, do you know what? My children, she's a European woman, she's got a husband from Africa, and he says, if I take the logical conclusion of this way of bringing up my children, and I take them to the relatives, the African relatives, they would see this as really bizarre. And for me, this way of seeing things is colonizing, or that other way of thinking. So the simple point I'm trying to make here is that what is colonizing for one person is sometimes decolonizing for another. So we really got to be careful when we speak and think. Sorry, so that's decolonizing childhood. All out of order. So final challenges or differences, though, I want to speak a little bit about traveled versus untraveled. My first response is to say it's vitally important for students, school kids, anyone, to be exposed, to have access to the other, to the distant, to what's happening in other countries, to what's happening in earlier centuries. But this requires an element of translation or of the wealth to be able to travel. It's not just a neutral thing. And I say, and then I thought to myself, okay, so the people of leisure who can travel, have money, will travel, and have got the time to analyze what they're traveling and thinking about, or who can read something very interesting about Sanskrit or something that happened centuries ago is wonderful. But the other groups of people who travel too, like slaves who forcibly forced to travel, or migrants at the moment, but it's not in a condition of leisure and a condition where we are supported to live. And the point I think I'm making behind that is that this is about social justice once again, because it's what access, what opportunities do you have to the resources that allow you to benefit from those situations. But another challenge, which is bringing us quite close to the end, is that of epistemic obedience. Now, I'd be interested to hear what other people have to say, because the educational project is so fundamentally about obedience and about assessment, and about meeting standards. Can somebody please tell me how epistemic disobedience can be something that we want to celebrate and work with in higher education? And if you've got the answer to that, then we need to work with that. So that's an area for future thinking. So it's an issue. So we go then on to the implications for teaching and learning. The first one, and I'm just repeating what I've said before, is the significance of the social alongside the cognitive justice and from a transformative point of view. This is essential. We cannot continue this conversation without having that alongside each other. Then, in relation to what I've just been saying, one has to bear in mind the various boundaries. If I can go back to that for 1 minute. Because you have people that say, oh, if it's just about African literature, the African canon, the students will be able to see themselves and it'll be easy. I hope I've made the point that it's not that simple. Because that, if that African canon has been produced by middle class and elite African writers, I'm going to challenge you to tell me that that's as accessible to students as anything else. So I'm problematizing that. And I'm problematizing a lot of writing that's been done in this country about the value of local knowledges and saying they are valuable, but they trip people up because the students get too ensconced in them and they don't always see that they're different to the other knowledges. Work has been done on this. But the opposite is to consider the implications of having to learn from the known and its complexities, and then people having to learn the unknown and a double bind. So if you're having to learn the unknown and through a medium which is already alienated or distant from you, there's a double level of learning or difficulty. So people who simply say that it's easy to distribute the canon and then everybody will have access to it are missing a central step of what it means to get to that canon. But I'm making the other point as well, is that the canon needs to be opened up and as well. And then I'm very much the end here to talk about the implications, a new role for the educator, which is both as an expert and as ignorant. And D'Souza Santos talks a lot about this. He talks about there's nothing, well, this is my words, but I'm paraphrasing him. He says there's nothing as ignorant as an expert who doesn't see where they are ignorant and sees the other as ignorant and doesn't recognize their expertise. So we've got to be both. We've got to take the role on seriously, what we were appointed to do, but we've also got to be open and ignorant. And there's a lovely book by Jacques Rancière called The Ignorant Schoolmaster, by the way. And just something light there. And then, as an educator, one has to be a collaborator across geographic zones, disciplines, and if I go back to D'Souza Santos, in alliances. So there's a need for translation and working in alliances, so across disciplines and north and south. And I'm just going to end with my own future plans, because this is clearly not something that I've been working on in the last 20 years, although I've been drawing on my work in the last 20 years. And I'm saying that I'm going to continue as an educator, mindful of the sociology of absences, and the fact that as I speak to you, and as I've been as a high school teacher and educator, I perpetuate harm, epistemic damage, by ignorance, complacency, not knowing, and I'm walking forward with that knowledge. But I believe I still can contribute. In terms of research that I'm hoping to be doing with people from Southern African rurality, which relates a lot to decolonization, and some of my friends in the room, Kibi and Tia, will be walking that path with me. And I'm hoping to write a book on cognitive justice in higher education, and Gert, I'll be consulting you on that one. And there's the open book in front of you. And just in case that final slide takes a long time to permeate, what it is a picture of, it's from the 1890 period, published in Punch, and it's a lecture on the Darwinian approach about the evolution of species. But if you see the people on the right, the little creatures, and then they become rats, and then they become the monkeys. But and the speech is about the evolution of speech. And of course, you see the man sleeping at night in front of, listening to this. So thank you very much for staying awake.
Thank you. Well, I want to begin by reflecting on Brenda's choice of topic. And I had expected that Brenda would focus, given her academic and scholarly trajectory and professional development, that she would focus on the scholarship of learning and teaching, in particular issues of academic development and support, the challenges of underpreparedness and so forth. That in the true tradition, whatever the tradition of the institution is, she would profess the knowledge she has developed in the past 20 years, focus on the lessons we've learned in academic development, the ongoing challenges, and chart new directions for research and practice, especially since in the context of academic development underpreparedness, just over half our students graduate or leave the university without graduating, without a qualification. So there's a lot that we need to think and learn about and still do in that context. It's interesting, as an aside, that in all the noise about decolonization of the curriculum and knowledge, the students have not pointed out to this fact, that just over 50% of the students who enter higher education leave without a qualification. It's a revolving door back into unemployment and poverty. Instead of focusing on what she should be professing on, I suspect, Brenda has chosen to move out of the comfort zone, to focus on a topical issue which is intensely political. I think it's refreshing that she's chosen to go into a new field while linked to teaching and learning, in which, as she says in her paper, she may even have been dismissive of in the past. It's not just new terrain for her, but it's also dangerous terrain, because it comes at a personal cost, or possible personal cost, as she found out when it was pointed out to her that speaking about decolonization, she was not, as a white academic, she was part of the system. And as I discovered in attending a recent seminar at Wits University, that being part of the system didn't mean you were only white. The paper was being presented by an ex-vice chancellor who was a student activist and leader in the 1980s. And he was told in no uncertain terms that he had nothing to contribute to understanding the current moment of student protest. So I want to commend Brenda for sort of for moving out of the safe option, for being brave, and for sticking her neck out. I think it's important, despite all of the noise and the challenges of young people who go on the rampage and so forth, that the academic community continues to raise questions, so not to be cowed into submission, not to be afraid to express views, and to engage with the issues that are being raised by the students. Because we're in a different world from the world of Biko in the 1970s. We're in a constitutional democracy. We want all of the voices to be heard, because the issues, as Brenda has pointed out, are complex and there are no simple answers. I think it's important for that community also to recognize it's an exciting moment, I think, in higher education if we rise to the challenge and recognize that what the students are saying, or they're pointing to problems that we may not have dealt with, and I'll come back to that. And to do so in a manner that's not dismissive of the student voice, in the same way that we would expect students not to be dismissive of the academic voice. And it struck me recently at a workshop where there was a discussion on a proposal on a project on the decolonization of the curriculum, which was being discussed with a set of institutions, not UJ, and with a set of senior academics, where after talking about how excited they were by the student protest, what a great moment it was in higher education, when it came to the nitty-gritties of the project, the response, what's the problem? We review the curriculum every year. Why don't we just add some books online from black writers? That should solve the problem. I'm simplifying. Okay. And it seems to me that is to misunderstand the problem. So I want to, against that background, make two comments, which are complementary and hopefully build on the insights that Brenda has provided us with. I intended to do a critique, but apparently the instructions I got said the protocol, a tradition, institutional tradition, it may be a UJ tradition, is you're not supposed to critique. And that may tell you something about knowledge and power, and we can talk about it at some other time. I was also told that if I don't stick to the protocol and tradition, I have a courtesy office for those of you who don't know at UJ, that I may well lose my office. So I thought I'd better stick to the tradition and make some complimentary comments to add to Brenda's. The first point I want to make, and it flows from this concern about the way in which academics were responding to the notion that curriculum is about, you know, we change the curriculum and we review it and so forth. And I suspect it may not be happening in every department, in every institution. But that the demand for decolonization is more than the demand for the decolonization of changing the curriculum or adding new text or subtracting text from the curriculum. I think it is much more fundamental. It's about how knowledge and the assumptions and values that underpin how knowledge is conceived, constructed, and transmitted is reflected in the way that the university as an institution is organized, as a social institution. In a sense, it's about institutional culture. It's about the symbols that permeate the institution and how those symbols and the privileging of those symbols is reflected in the learning and teaching process at the coalface, in the lecture room and the seminar room. In a sense, for those of you, I studied sociology many years ago, it's about as much about the formal curriculum as it's about the hidden curriculum, which was in vogue in the 70s and 80s, but I don't come across it much these days. It's about what we privilege, not just the knowledge we privilege, but the values and the cultural traditions that we privilege. Okay? I haven't worn the gown this evening because I've never worn an academic gown in my life. I've not even been to a graduation ceremony. I do have some degrees, but I haven't graduated formally by going through the rituals of a graduation ceremony. So whose tradition do we celebrate when we wear an academic gown? It's an institutional tradition. Where does it emanate from? Is it a tradition of universities in parts other than the West? I'm not sure what they did in Timbuktu in the institutes of learning that were there historically. They may or may not have worn gowns, I have no idea. So I think we need to be open and questioning. I suspect, and it was interesting, you know, let's celebrate that Brenda owns this process, but the comment she made about the leader or the representative of Black Thought, who when she raised issues about the pomp and ceremony attached to this, said, own the ceremony. I suspect if you were to push the student movement that in future graduation ceremonies will not involve an academic gown and you will not be kept, you may have a revolution on your hands. So the demand for decolonization, I think, is a demand for inclusion, recognition, affirmation. It's what in Brenda's paper the student at the panel said, we don't see ourselves in the institution. So it's more than just about the curriculum, it's about how the institution is structured. And seeing yourself in the institution, affirming, integrating, including, is not an easy task. It's not an easy task because I think, as Brenda suggests, we're often not aware. It may not even be obvious what we do, because we've been so socially, it's so socially embedded in the way we do things. And I want to use an example about how process of inclusion may actually result in exclusion. And it refers to not a university setting, but a school setting. Primary school, Parkview Senior, that some of you may know. My kids went there. It's a small liberal school, progressive, full of academics from WITS and not sure of UJ. The school is committed to cultural integration. It has kids from all different sorts of communities and so forth. So as part of its project to recognize and affirm different cultures, annually, when there are different religious and cultural celebrations, it has a school assembly. So if it's Rosh Hashanah or Passover, the Jewish kids would get up and explain to the rest of the school what the meaning of the cultural tradition is. If it's Diwali, the Hindu kids would get up and so on. At the end of the year, there's a school play, which is to celebrate Christmas. Everybody participates in the school play. So, in the process of including all the other cultures, but one culture is being privileged, or one religious tradition is being privileged, because everybody participates and explains what Christmas means, but when you're doing Diwali or Eid or whatever else, it's only those kids who come from those communities that get up to the stage and explain. So it's both including but also excluding. It's creating a form of otherness and separateness. It's privileging one religious tradition and separating the others from that. So I think it is important to reflect deeply about what it means to decolonize the curriculum. The example that Brenda used from Hawaii is a similar one. Because we make assumptions of what we're trying to do, but in the process we may reproduce the very thing that we want to replace. The second point I want to make, or the second comment, is related to the whole issue of decolonization as a framework for entering into this debate. And it seems to me that decolonization as a conceptual framework is too narrow and limiting. It's narrow and limiting, in part Brenda referred to some of it in the closing of her lecture, because it's about replacing. In the political sense, decolonization is replacing a foreign colonial power with a local indigenous power. It says nothing about whether you change the institutional structure, the nature of social and economic relations in the society. It's replacing one set of elites with another set of elites. In this context, it's replacing the argument for the decolonization of knowledge is about replacing white with black, Freud with Fanon, Northern with Southern knowledge. And knowledge, as Brenda pointed out, is a lot more complicated. Whose knowledge do we replace? If we replace white with black knowledge, is it the knowledge of the elites, the experts? Is it knowledge of the workers, men, women? That whole range of divisions in the knowledge hierarchy. So that the danger, there are two dangers in a sense, with decolonization as a framework to enter into this debate. There's the danger of essentialism, racial essentialism, other essentialisms, as I indicate. And there's a danger of conservatism, quite social, harking back to the past, which puts modernity against tradition. You know, post the Constitutional Court judgment, Jacob Zuma referred in a meeting with traditional leaders that we need to find African solutions to African problems. And he went on to suggest that the law, read Western, is cold. The body, read African, is warm. Are we harking back to a past? Is it simply about tradition versus modernity? I suspect if you take it to its logical conclusion, then the students in traditional culture, young people don't have anything to say. They need to listen to the elders. You can just shut the debate immediately by the experts or the elders talking. So I think it's a lot more complicated. And it seems to me that the starting point of departure for any project on decolonization of the curriculum is to recognize, and it may not be, very prominent in the debates, is the universality of knowledge. Is to recognize not universality in the sense that privileges one knowledge system or one knowledge tradition, but along the lines that Achille Mbembe talks about opening up, recognizing that all knowledges should be in dialogue with each other in order to address the problems that we face. It's also about recognizing the interdependence of knowledge. The Western canon historically has been influenced by a whole range of knowledge traditions and cultures, which we don't affirm and recognize. So we present the Western canon without recognizing where some of it, the Enlightenment, some of the ideas and issues that emerge with the Enlightenment can be traced back. There was a man writing in Spain, not in Ottoman Spain, in I forget what it's now called, who was writing about the interpretation of dreams in the 13th and 14th century, long before Freud came onto the scene. Nobody knows of him. And so on. So it does seem to me that we need to look at, in the sense that Brenda was talking about, to what's the language, the de-hegemonization of knowledge. It's a much better way, it seems, of framing the problem than to look at it as a decolonization. Decolonization, sense replacing. What do we do? How do we go forward in conclusion? Well, firstly, I think it may be useful to remind institutions of higher learning that the problems are not new. That the issue of voice, of recognition, of inclusion has been there since 1994. In 2008, the then Minister of Education, following the Raids incident at the University of Free State, established a committee that was chaired by Crane Sowerdean. Go and read the report of that committee. All of the issues that the students are raising today are outlined in that report. It gave voice to those who felt discriminated, felt racism was an issue, gender discrimination, and so forth. The committee suggested a whole agenda for change, which it recommended both to higher education institutions, and it recommended it to the state, to government. I dare say that nothing has happened. If you were to look at the recommendations of that commission and the issues it raised, if only half of what it found and was suggesting had been implemented, we may not find ourselves where we do today. The crisis that we face is because we failed to transform higher education institutions, not because we're not aware of the problem, but we seem to be paralyzed about what to do. In relation to curriculum, it seems to me, I'm not sure it's very useful to have panels, either disciplinary panels, as in some institutions, how are we going to change the curriculum in sociology or political science, philosophy and so forth. I think all of that is important, not unimportant. But it seems to me that what we require is an institution-wide process, not dissimilar to what happens in the Ivy Leagues in the US and some of the major Australian research institutions, which review their curriculum, undergraduate curriculum, on a maybe 5 or 10 yearly basis, I forget. And the purpose is not to see is sociology up to other latest sociological writings in the syllabus or the curriculum, but what is it that we expect the graduate to leave the university with? What is it, in our context, what are the social, political, ethical, technical skills and competencies that we think a graduate in post-apartheid South Africa, located in the African continent and in the broader world, what are the skills and competencies that he or she should be leaving the university with, and which will enable them in a positive and to contribute to addressing the problems that the society, whether they're linked in South Africa or wherever else they go, how do we bring together, what is it that they require? If we start that as a curriculum debate, it's not issues about institutional culture, there's a much bigger issue. It may start giving us insight about what is it that we require to change in the curriculum. How is it that we can, as one vice chancellor said at the time of the Raids, that our universities can produce graduates who can do the kinds of things that those students did? Because if the university is a home which challenges you, as Brenda was saying, what are we doing to challenge our students to think about what does it mean to be human in South Africa today? Thank you. Oh, sorry, let me also congratulate Brenda. I think it's been a
ladies and gentlemen, if Amit had gone on any longer, I would have been awarding a second inaugural address as the president. I just want to say thank you very much, Amit. That was great as a respondent to Brenda. But I just at the risk of sounding like I'm now responding to the respondent, I just want to say that academic development is a lot more political and has moved a long way since you were involved in academic development. I would not say that the issues around decolonization is not an academic development matter. I feel passionately about that because academic development also falls within my own portfolio. And I have two executive directors, Elizabeth Akert and Rory Ryan, who I'm sure would argue with you as well. But ladies and gentlemen, we've now come to the last part of the tradition, and that is to gown our esteemed, distinguished professor. Brenda, will you come over? You are okay. We now gown you. Congratulations.
The University of Johannesburg. Rethink, reinvent.